Thank you very much. Martin, let me now move on to you. Your team in the upcoming WDR on jobs is actually developing a new framework to guide policymakers in the design of policies to promote the creation of good jobs. How does this framework apply during economic contraction? What are the issues and trade-offs that countries need to consider when designing policy responses to an economic downturn? Peter has just cited some of those contradictory, what he sees as contradictory policies, which I think speaks to issues of trade-offs. And should we protect employment or let markets adjust and simply protect the income of those becoming unemployed?
Thank you, Renos. Very difficult questions. Let me start by saying that perhaps a new framework can be too ambitious a word for what we're trying to do with the report with my team, which is more to bring together elements from research and thinking that help us make sense of the way jobs matter for development, perhaps in a slightly different way. But I will not want to use something as ambitious as a new framework, which may suggest a new theory or something like that. Second, also, let me make the point that world development reports are about development, not about short-term fluctuations. So, of course, we think about short-term fluctuations and jobs in short-term fluctuations, but within the broader framework of development. So the world development report that will be launched this October will not be about this crisis, will be about jobs and crisis in development more generally. We are very fortunate, as I said, to have this report that the ILO and the bank have put together as one of our inputs. It's an extremely valuable resource, so the timing for us is very good. And again, in the case of the World Development Report, we have a very good collaboration with the ILO in terms of discussing the issues. In reading this report and in following the discussion and in trying to share where our thinking is at this point in the preparation of the report, I think there are four things that come to mind in terms of crisis and jobs. First, one point that was made by Tamara at the end of her intervention, which is the data, the knowing. One of the things that the crisis reveals is how little we know about what happens in the short term in many developing countries in relation to employment. I want to also wear my hat, a previous hat I had during the crisis. When the crisis hit, I was a lead economist for the program in Vietnam, and so I was following a lot of these issues from the perspective of a developing country in the transition from low income to middle income. One will not claim that Vietnam is a representative country of anything, it's a very special country, but at least it gave me also some insights that I think are valuable. And despite Vietnam being a country with a very good database, everybody uses the household expenditure surveys of Vietnam. I've been 20 years of working with the statistical office. We were completely orphaned in terms of understanding what was going on in terms of employment. Of course, that suggests that one agenda is a data agenda, but even there I would say it's one where one has to be careful. The thing that comes to mind is let's have a high-frequency labor force survey. But these are expensive things. They tend to cover the capital cities at best. You can expect in many countries to have one every year, so it's a good starting point. But I would say one of the exercises is to think what kind of data we can have to think about crisis. One thing that ended up being extremely useful in Vietnam and was done in several other countries was to have focus group discussions very systematic across a range of areas, from the spot markets in the cities where the daily workers get together to get jobs, to handicraft village, to rural areas. And I think we learned a lot from those insights. So having an inventory of where will we know what's going on, what will we know what is going on in terms of employment and in terms of earnings, I think is a very important part of the readiness. That's on data. Second, the second comment that comes to mind is on concepts. We tend to think about crisis and unemployment. And unemployment is a very relevant concept when you have more advanced economies where wage employment is the norm. It's a trickier concept in many of our client countries, in low-income countries, where a lot of employment is self-employment, is even when it's in formal firms, it's informal employment, and we're tracking what happens to people and what the options are, is very difficult. Again, if I take the example of Vietnam, the unemployment rate probably didn't move. What happened is a lot of people went back to their villages, went to rural areas, were underemployed, were not doing overtime. So a second point is, let's think, even if we were to have these high frequency labor force surveys in around the country, let's think what is that we should be asking there to have the full picture on employment, underemployment, and earnings. The third point, and I think is what you hinted at in your question, Renos, is this big question that Jürgen was tackling on protecting workers or protecting jobs in crisis. And I think it's one of the questions we tackle where we use this framework, to call it in some way, in the World Development Report, is when is the conventional wisdom that protecting workers is the best response, the most appropriate, and when there are caveats to the conventional wisdom. And I would like to answer the question exactly in the way Jürgen framed it. It's a matter of job creation and destruction. In the normal cycle of job creation and destruction, the best thing you can do indeed is to protect workers, because you facilitate the reallocation. When you have one activity or one sector that has a shock, that has lower productivity, people can move to places where they will have, again, the average productivity of the economy, and so you will not suffer in terms of output. But the answer creates more problem when you have these massive dislocations, when you have these systemic shocks, as was the crisis, where you have a collapse in jobs, so you have massive job destruction, but it takes a lot of time for jobs to pick up. And one of the ideas in this framework we use for the World Development Report is that jobs have a value that goes beyond the earnings they provide. There are intangible assets that go with them. So the kind of productivity loss that you can get when you have one of these collapses, if you are just to help workers move to other jobs, they will move to places where they will be much less productive or not productive at all. I think two more nuances on that thinking is, if we look at the experience of this crisis, in developing countries, very few people had access to what we will consider the right response in terms of protecting workers. Unemployment insurance, even when it existed, only reached a very small minority of those who lost jobs. There were good public works programs put in place, but in many cases, these public work programs have a design that is related to poverty. So they have earnings which tend to be very low, and many of the job losses we saw were in manufacturing and other sectors at higher levels of earnings, where perhaps that was not the alternative. So we have both a conceptual reason why the protecting workers only may not work in this big crisis, and a practical reason is that we may not always have the mechanisms in developing countries to do so. When we look at reading this report, it's interesting that many of the responses were in terms of protecting jobs. So in an uncoordinated manner, each one doing it in its own way, and it goes from the very structured response of, say, Germany and Switzerland with the wage subsidies. But if I look, for instance, at the sectoral policies, the report says in the low and middle income countries, a sectoral budget of $520 billion had the largest allocation for support to manufacturing. And when we look at labor demand policies, a lot of the labor demand policies more or less accomplish the same thing. And so I think in terms of implications for policy, the agenda that comes here is to think when is that one should consider protecting jobs, and when is that protecting workers is really the best way to go. And second, how to do it in a way that doesn't become an entitlement that can be phased out when getting out of the crisis. The point that Tamar made is when you get into these things that you have to be thinking how you will get out of them and not as an afterthought. Final point, and is something that Ronnie mentioned, is issues of coordination. If everybody in a big crisis ends up protecting jobs in, say, the export sectors, what are the implications for others? So this is a kind of policy response that brings the issues of protectionism, that brings the issues of taking jobs from others. And one of the issues there is that we don't have good coordination mechanisms to handle this situation. Most of the actions for jobs do not happen through trade measures, so the WTO architecture is not always the entry point. Some of the agreements, like the Global Jobs Pact, are more on the side of making sure that rights are protected, but not on the coordination side. So perhaps that this one fourth area, in addition to data, concepts, and policies, is the coordination aspect that comes out of this.